I am grateful, and once again I feel honored and privileged to be here and on being given the opportunity by NSU, and especially I am grateful to Professor Mundal and my very old friend Sridip for inviting me for this lecture series. I hope I'll be contributing something meaningfully today, and I'll be basically speaking on, as already Imadriti has already introduced to you, I'll be speaking on definitely women and their memoirs and their diaries. And today I'll be particularly emphasizing on what has been already published and recorded. And I do this very consciously, and published and recorded not of course in this people's project, but in other projects, similar projects which have been taken in the past. And my point of view, or my objective, was to find out what we can learn from those already past done projects, to learn from the methods, to also avoid the pitfalls, if I may say, if they at all have, and in a way to avoid also if what we can call as plagiarism. So what we can basically avoid, and what we can learn from what has already gone by, and what we can also carve out from this, that means what has not been covered, what has not been done in those projects, how far can we do that in our project and to take it to greater heights. And also one thing which I would like to emphasize, which is again not the least, I would be talking definitely about women. And women who belong to the lesser strata of society, and I would be putting in questions as to whether women think differently. Do we really need to think about women differently, and do we need to segregate them as interviewees of Partition? With that, I think I will go over there, because I would also like you to see some excerpts of the interviews which are again, as I repeat, published. And I consciously do not infringe any copyrights, I feel so. The thrust of this people's Partition is on unknown voices. That means we want to know those who haven't been read. So on some free Googling, you know, I found and I came upon this. And in the published, if at all, you know, we get a published version of this, I have given the URL also. This is a poem which I would like you all to note. And the particular, I won't read it since you see. Sharmistha, and the protagonist, if I may say, claims that she is neither a Hindu nor Muslim. I am harping on the important ideas. And she wants to leave this cursed land, and that had torn her country and people in peace. And she wants to tear the holy books and the idols, and more importantly, the last three lines. She has chopped off her fine long hair, and all that makes her a woman, wants to be thrown away. And she claims that by chopping off her hair and by throwing away all that has made her a woman, she gets a rebirth. Now, with this, you know, there was a question in my mind as to whether this gives us a clue that this protagonist, who is supposed to be a woman, which is evident again, she, that is it that she is a victim? She is a spoil of Partition? She is somebody who is the usen through property of the patriarchy, and therefore she wants to do away with her configuration as a woman, as a sexual identity as a woman? Or is it that this is a sort of a defiance that she wants to sort of as a mark that I chop off my hair, I become sort of a man, and I make my statement that you cannot cower me down with all that you do, the patriarchy. So these are the two questions, again the ambivalence with which we move on. Before I get you to read this, which you can read already, I thought that, you know, the earlier poem which presented, again if I may go back once again, you know, which presents a sort of a question or an ambivalence as to whether then the woman is a victim who is a migrant or a spoiler partition, or whether she is the defiant other. You know, this makes us, or as researchers, to be able to delve or to bring up questions to our mind as to then how do we treat women of partition. With this, you see, I take up certain interviews. And the first interview, you see, is by Shurobala Dash. And she is an inmate of Bashberia permanent liability camp. And she is somebody who you will notice, you know, the phrases which are noticeable, which she had told in her interview, is that conditions have gone from bad to worse. This is her her feeling. And that because the conditions are so bad, she is not very keen on rehabilitation. And the last line, I want to die here. Now the question is that then if this is such a dismal picture, and this has been recorded by the Women's Department of Jadavpur University, that project, and this book is, as you see, by Bakshidas Gupta Ghosh. Now in this particular interview that has been taken, what is so new? What do we learn from here, you know? She already says that she wants to die. So the typical, you know, peculiar idea that she is already a victim, you know. So what are we to learn so new from this already very, very desperate woman? I'll read a bit also where I feel so sheer hopelessness and despair in the voice of Shurobala seems to reiterate the idea of women as useless exchanges of partition. Yet I go back to that poem, you know, the introspective chopping of her hair of the protagonist of Joyasmita Ray's poem. Her throwing away of all that made her a woman and being reborn does indicate her configuration as a spoil of war, as a sexual commodity by the state patriarchal machinery. Or is it that the woman just hopes to get away unnoticed from the greedy eyes of soldiers, BSF, men et al., while crossing the borders? Is it the psychosis of fear or an act of defiance? I'll quote another very important critic of partition and the victims of partition, Rita Manchanda. It's given over there. This is from a very important article, you know, Gender Conflict and Displacement, Contesting Infantilization of Forced Migrant Women, which is based on her field study, which shows her concern about the presumed passivity of women refugees conferred upon by discourses which are naturalized in practice. That means everybody takes it for granted that women should be refugees. Again, I would ask you to please concentrate on what Manchanda harps on. Her identity and her individuality are collapsed into the homogeneous category of victim and community devoid of agency. And she is unable to represent himself. She is powerless and superfluous. And the last part, abject rightlessness, easily naturalized. Because our patriarchal, acculturated state system, women are largely seen as non-subjects, enjoying at best secondary citizenship. So you see, Manchanda tries to tell that this is basically what has been happening all throughout, in all the projects. You know, you take it for granted. This is very naturalized into us. You know, even the people who take the interview, when they go, it is in their mind that these are victims we are going to interview. Many interviews talking about their experience of partition in Eastern India in 1947 and 1971 have categorically used the reference points as home and earth. With this, again, you know, I am going into a different domain. You see, this could happen, you know, why do we, essentially see them as victims is because, you know, when women give their interviews, the published interviews, I repeat again, we see that they continuously revolve themselves around their men, their home, their hearth, as if their entire identity, their entire configuration is or harps on the men in their lives, okay, the home in their lives. So is it that displacement or partition is because of movement from one place to another and that cataclysmic event, or is it that because they have lost their men and their home? These are some very crucial questions. So they keep on talking about their husbands, their fathers, their children, and understanding the impact of the event. We go on to the next excerpt of the interview from Shukumari Choudhury. She lives in Shantoshpur, Jadavpur, and she recalls her arrival and experience as refugee in Kolkata, 1946-1947. And I would ask you once again to please note that it's a long excerpt, but my kaka was based in this city, Kolkata. Then again, please go down, you see, she'll say, I received the dreadful news that my husband, my first husband, she was married the next time, was no more. And I started crying inconsolably. And then, you know, from Kolkata, I returned to my parents in Hingolgan. So, you know, she's migrating, she's dispersing. Constantly, you know, the state of dispersal is from one man to another. And then from parents where there is again a man. And then I went twice to my in-laws' place. And then again, you know, once I went back to perform the last rites of my husband. And then again, husband and father-in-law had been mercilessly hacked to death. My father brought me back from my in-laws' house. The only important, you know, I don't say again, you know, please pardon me if I am, you know, if I sound very harsh and if I sound probably unethical to myself as being a woman. But it's not so. I don't mean that. But what I mean to say is that, is it that a woman would be known again, you know, by the men whom she has lost? The only important thing I felt over here was that she tries to say that, yes, she was a week, you know, there to collect money being distributed by Gandhiji's camp. Here, you know, something very crucial was there. You know, we had probably hoped, you know, she had talked more about, you know, Gandhiji's camp. I read through the entire interview. You can go back, you know, the books are available. But unfortunately, she has nothing more to say about that Gandhiji camp. Okay, so we will come back to this. That the loss and dislocation is largely due to the sudden disappearance of father figures from a familiar scenario is repeated women by many women in many such interviews. The next person, you know, the long interviews are here, but I'll read through certain excerpts. Bithi Chakraborty, she lives in Shodhpur. She repeatedly in a similar way remembers her Mamu, who had arrived at Shalda station to receive her. This is not here over there. I'm just, you know, reading excerpts. She had to go back to Bangladesh in 1947 because her Jathamashai was seriously ill. She remembers how her father became seriously ill after her migration to Kolkata and the way Chotomasho helped her family. In spite of the fact that Bithi, you will see the later on, I'll show you an excerpt. Bithi is a very feisty fighter. She later on took up, you know, the entire responsibility of her family. She has this sense of insecurity initially, you know. So this protracted sense of insecurity is evident from the presence and the absence of father figures. Like Bithi and Shukumari, there are many, many women. The figure during that time when I had read the published interviews, 2,910 women, Bengali women, they were widows who lived in Amarbari at Brindabon. So, you know, many such women who live at Brindabon, they say similar things, you know, after having migrated and gone. So, show abject despair due to loss of husbands and family. And these widows were interviewed by Shubharanjan Dasgupta. Many of us are, you know, we know about him. He's a very important, you know, contributor to the Partition project in Jadavpur. So, one of the inmates, Ila Bondopadhyay, she had said something very interesting, very striking. Till I die, I shall chant Hori's name. I do not want to go anywhere. I cling to my Gopal. Fine, okay. Shushila, Gopika, Chopula Sundari, all aged between 70 and 92 in a similar way, find anchorage in Sham or Gopal. Incidentally, I would ask, you know, many of us, I think we'll understand, is understand that you see Ghori or Gopal becomes again very strangely a supplant of the father figures whom, you know, they have lost. So, you know, the idea is that again, you know, wherever I am, my loss is of the father and the man and the supplanting with Gopal and Hari. So wherever I am, I cling to my, you know, father and the father figure. So Hari and Gopal. So for these women, therefore, the concept of violation, uprooting and subsequent displacement is not entirely a matter of only crossing and borders from East to West Bengal, but the loss of patriarchal anchorage too that the partition resulted in. Scant attention has also been paid to women who had migrated to East Pakistan from the West. Some studies have been done, yes. I cannot say studies have not been done, many. I think many of you might be knowing more than, you know, what I can say today. Majority of the Muslims and those who chose to remain back also in the face of odds, particularly in the metropolis of Calcutta and also Tripura. Those like Kishwar Jahan and Nasima De incidentally married a Hindu, so Nasima De, she had other reasons to stay back in Kolkata, of course belonged to very educated families actively engaged in secular politics. This is one excerpt from the interview with Kishwar Jahan, who chose to stay back in Kolkata. Now, just one or two excerpts. Her family was involved with secular politics. Her father was active member of Congress. Her uncle was committed leader of the Communist Party. Again, I'll remind you, you know, we should not, no, I don't say we should not, but you know, my feeling is that, you know, going into these pitfalls of, you know, politics continuously, something which probably should be safeguarded against, probably. It's my, entirely my personal view, if we could in this project. But where it is inevitable, we have to. We have to. So, you know, if we go more into politics and our affiliations, you know, that becomes a very dangerous area to tread, probably. Again, okay? Your views are most welcome. We'll discuss about that. The decision to migrate had already been taken, as she's saying, but, you know, she says that we were a patriarchal family, therefore chose not to. So these are a kind of, again, a different kind of women, you know, who chose to be out of this. There are other kinds of women, you know, say one, again, I didn't have time so much to include in, like say the story of Akia. Akia, who stayed in Tripura, who's the wife of Dudu Mia, and we know that Tripura is basically very Hindu, you know, kind of a place where, you know, Muslim people were kept as, you know, if I may say so, you know, to serve again. So, you know, with the loss of this entire, the partition, you know, the scenario changed. And Akia somehow, you know, chose to stay back in spite of all the tortures which went on. And I chose again not to, that was a long interview because of lack of time, didn't, in, you know, include that. But, you know, Meenakshi Sen reports something about Akia, why she chose to stay back, you know. And this is again a different perspective of Akia. And again a male, sort of male perspective, that Akia could not come out of, you know, the influence of Dudu Mia, her courtyard, her kitchen garden, that very comfortable space, you know, which would have made her, you know, feel that she is losing her original home. So she chose to stay back for different reasons altogether. To this retinue of, again, you know, barring Jahan's interview, these overprotected infantile women belong Sultana Farooq Shoban, Taiba Ahmad, Nazara Haq. These women have migrated from West Bengal to East Bengal. They were interviewed by Debjani Dotto in Bangladesh. And they had left West Bengal for East Bengal. And most of them reported, I quote, sheer fright and a gnawing sense of insecurity and helplessness which prompted them to leave. This particular, you know, sheer fright and insecurity without having, you know, gone through the violence themselves. There's a very interesting book by Joya Basu, you know, where she says this phenomenon to be a soft violence, you know. Soft violence which was typical of this East, you know, protracted and soft violence where you are not a victim of the partition, but at the same time you are victimized by the rumors. And therefore, you know, because of the sheer fright, you keep on moving and keep on following the others. I can't help but in one Bangla boy, I must refer to Doyamoy's Kotha, Sunanda Shikdar. Now there are lots of reference to this, you know, migrant, you know, populations because of sheer, you know, what this Joya, Jayanti Basu says, you know, soft violence, rumor, and because of rumor, people, masses and masses of people, you know, migrating. Ekta khub notun again, pardon me, Monon, Shankhochil. Shankhochil, a very new inclusion, you know, to this idea, you know, of partition through, you know, very young girl's voice, you know, Sharbani Putodundo. You can also look up that particular book, all these creative works which deal about, you know, this soft violence. I move on. My area today is not these creative writings. You see, what I'm trying to say is that these people have all said, you know, very conservative households. They talk about horse-drawn carriages curtained on all sides. And they keep on talking. We left India 2 days before partition. We could have easily stayed back. But my father cherished different dreams. Nazara Haq said that she had to follow her husband. So, you know, these kind of women. You see, these are memories. These are memories and these are particular kinds of memories. Memories of a kind of an insecurity as we are harping on. And this insecurity is justified in a way. It's justified in a way as Hallback, you know, Maurice Hallback's very important book on collective memory, you know, where Hallback has said that yes, when we lose our familiar reference points, this is a latter part of the Hallback's book, you know, from where I have borrowed this. But Hallback basically tries to say that, you know, when people lose their familiar reference points, like the object, like the people with which they stay, you know, they feel as if their entire personality is lost. They are leaving behind a part of their entire self. And Hallback cites an example, as you see, you know, the family, the group may change owing to death and marriage, and or it may change location as it grows richer or poorer, the father is transferred. From then on, neither the group nor the collective memory remains the same, but neither have the physical surroundings. And Hallback says that these cataclysmic events like partition also, you know, are a part of these kind of, you know, feelings where, you know, the group is not the same and therefore the memory is not the same anymore. The only way over here the family can remain united, even though neuromentally, is to recall their old home and layout. So this is one part. But you see, recent scholars, they have differed in the projection of women like this, from the interviews. Orchid Basugo Choudhury, Pallavi Chakraborty, Rita Manchanda, Joya Chatterjee, they refuse to homogenize these experiences of women as victims and survivors of partition. While it is already evident that women from very educated families and elite groups could ward off the seeming and the real threats of partition, seeming, why I have told you, women from middle and lower class adopted different strategies. While most of them were compelled to become refugees due to real or imagined violence, many who realized the predicament refused to accept the label of being an economic liability of the nascent nation state. While the state's attitude towards refugees shifted from acknowledging the sacrifice for the independence of the nation to seeing them as objects of charity, around 1953 and 60, the stance of refugees hardened towards not seeing themselves as ones who were at the mercy of state charity. And I think most of us know, nothing new I am saying. The refugees therefore preferred to use the terms udbastu, pastuhara, one who had lost his or her homeland, to refer to themselves instead of refugees. While West Bengal considered male refugees to be given temporary support unless old and infirm, the females were meted out with a different fate. Those with families, that is the male members, were dumped with the patriarch, and those without became permanent liabilities of the state. In this case, the discrimination between Punjabi female refugees and Bengali female refugees was evident. And this is something which I got from Economic and Political Weekly, that while the government gave a dole of rupees 20 per person to a Punjabi refugee, Bengali refugees got only rupees 12 per person. The negligence and state apathy pushed many of the surviving women to become breadwinners, activists, and even messengers of peace. Nomita Roy Choudhury is such a case in the point, you know, who goes out, the alternative idea against this victimization. So she has gone out, and this is, you know, in Bangla transcription and again with a translation, that she feels that yes, you know, I was somebody who was into the family, very much a family person, but you know, later on the bigger world became actually my family. That's the idea over here, you know, the gradual shift and move of the private to the public. This is also happening, you know, with many, many such women who were interviewed. The same Sukumari Chaudhary who felt helpless, you know, she later on, you know, she became a very, very active person, you know, who had participated in retaining Jabardakhal colonies or, you know, the squatter colonies, you know, and she had forcibly occupied herself. She had also, you know, joined government-sponsored, as you see, you know, violence. And very interestingly, please see over here, she had, she refers to the common weapons, the kitchen utensils used as weapons to go through the agitations. And ultimately, she talks about, you know, Nari Shiva Shangos. I have deliberately eschewed some parts of the interview because there were conscious political affiliations. What is Nari Shiva Shango? What affiliations were there? So, you know, she had got a job and she had been the breadwinner. The same Bithi Chakraborty who was earlier lamenting to us, you know, she had lost mama, jatha, kaka, you know, she takes up a teaching job. And, you know, she completed her BA, she takes up teaching, and you see the ambivalence again, that fear typical of a woman, that when she comes back home, you know, she feels, you know, a fright in the dark when she comes back. And Bithi's family, the interviews reveal they lived in a cow shed. There were small windows, stuffy, sultry, no facility of drinking water, only a shallow well. They had a spacious home in Thanata before migrancy. A house with 121 acres of land and a very sprawling campus. I won't take much time, but a little bit, 10 minutes more. Okay. So, you see, I had personally, you know, interviewed many people. Privately, you know, not to be a part of any enterprise, just out of my own, you know, own feeling, you can say, very, you know, passionate and emotional. Just to share one interview, you know, this is Shikhadi, you know, who used to work at my parents' home, Shikha Haldar, and, you know, she had migrated from Jhigorgacha, Bangladesh, and very recently, 1994. And she had gone through all this, and I had asked Shikhati, you know, that was it because of, you know, all the religious kind of stories that we see, you know, communal reasons? Shikhati says, no. That's all because, you know, I wanted to get a good job, you know. My husband used to beat me, and therefore, you know, I wanted to do something worthwhile. So I came away. But you see, again, you know, Shikhati wanted to have a better life. So she managed to get a, you know, what I recorded was a ration card. Shikhadi had managed to get, you know, some other kinds of very useful things, which are Aadhaar card, yes, she told me. What she couldn't manage is a passport. And she yearned for that, and I was trying to help her, and Shikhadi has passed away recently. And I'm very passionate about Shikhadi because I was all throughout with her in her journey, and Shikhadi lost all her organs, vital organs, because, you know, she was just trying to survive her best, you know, with three of her children. And, you know, she lost her eyes, she lost her organs because of, you know, arthritis, horrible arthritis. She was afflicted with that. But Shikhadi was valiant and defiant till her death. She made her mark that, you know, I won't be called a refugee. So that was Shikhadi. And when someday, you know, if it is published, then Shikhadi, we will see also Shikhadi in a published interview. I move on to, you know, the last part with one or two more interviews of these different kinds of women, you know, and some comments, you know, which come from, you know, the important, you know, this is Orchid Basu who is commenting, you know, that this is a very gradual, you know, movement which is coming of, you know, women who are moving from domestic sphere to the public sphere, and this gradual movement is making an important contribution to configuring women as other kinds of women. There are other kinds of women in partition, not the victims and not the sufferers only, especially in the East. One last interview which I quote is, this is, you know, Pramila Basu's interview. You know, this is on, you know, how the government promised them with a home and with a compensation and nothing had happened. And her idea that the bureaucracy works in its own way and we probably have our own way of working. But then, you know, Pramila was very hopeful that she will be able to do something of her own after she has migrated. Rachel Weber, 5 minutes more. Rachel Weber, you know, she is a feminist geographer. I would ask you to please note some important ideas over here. She says, you know, something very interesting. Most of these people, women who have been interviewed, you know, they had continuously said that their home in East Bengal was very sprawling and spacious. Many, many rooms, a lot of, you know, courtyard, adjoining courtyard. And therefore, you know, they didn't never needed, you know, to go out. With the coming into, you know, West Bengal, the spaces were so very restricted, cooped up, pigeonholes, that, you know, they felt they had to move out. So, you know, what was their private was compensated in West Bengal with the private household as well as a part of, you know, the public sphere into which they moved in. So, you know, the private in East Bengal was compensated in West Bengal with the private as well as the public. So, you know, the houses were compensated also with the public sphere into which they were gradually moving in. And this is very, very important. You see, a geographer commenting on this, a feminist geographer. So, this is something which is very interesting to note. Joya Chakraborty, and I end up with this and my comments on, you know, what I have observed and then your comments, you know, that the Punjabis, you know, probably there's a kind of a stepmotherly attitude of the, had been a stepmotherly attitude of the government towards the East Bengali migrants, you know. That is because, you know, the Nehru government felt that, again, I'm sorry, again, politically speaking, so quoting Joya Chatterjee, that the Nehru government felt that, you know, that the Bengalis had a choice. If you have a choice, then you are not a refugee. Refugees, according to their, you know, parlance and according to their definition, can only be people without choice. So the Punjabis didn't have a choice. When the Bengalis have a choice, then they cannot be refugees. And if they are not refugees per se, then there is no need as to why they should be getting compensation. And as to why, you know, they should be demanding one also. So, you know, that again, you know, justifies probably why these women, men, and also these women, why they should be, you know, going into these movements of squatting, you know, why they should be going into andolans or whatever we say, or why they should go on volition into becoming the bread owners, okay, or the bread earners, sorry, of their households. There are questions and ambivalences, therefore. I'll just quote, you know, I can't help literature look. So, you know, I teach English literature. So, I can't help, you know, quote Othello. Somehow, you know, Othello comes into my mind. And, you know, many of you might be very familiar with this phrase, you know, Othello before he kills Desdemona. And this is a very famous line. Bangla lokerao janben. I kissed the air, I killed thee. I feel, you know, this partition came as, you know, the promises of partition, you know, came as a kiss, you know, before the killing happened. So I kissed the air, I killed thee. And then you are killed. And ultimately, you know, Pramila finds that all the promises are into the thin air. So that's it. And in appendix, you know, I would say in the observation, you know, I feel that all these, you know, printed interviews and, you know, which I've collected from various, you can all collect definitely, you know, very easy to get at the click of a finger. And with some, you know. So my observations, again, you see, many of these interviews are very strong, very important and influential people have taken this. But you see, they have their pitfalls. You see, some of them had been vehemently used as propagandas for particular affiliations, groups, parties. They have not put in enough insight into what we call, many of us, most of us know, there were minority evacuee rights also. That means those who wanted to, you know, come back to East Bengalis who wanted to come back to Bengal or vis-a-vis, you know, the other way around, you know. What happens to them, you know? How do we consider? How did the government deal with? Do they have any other narratives? Okay. So are they also refugees and migrants? What state? What, you know, stage? This is one question which has not been dealt with. The interviews also do not elaborate enough on migrant women's engagement with social and community services. That means once you cross over, then you see, you become a part of, say, suppose you know you belong to the other community you are crossing over, you belong, you become a part of the majority community now. So as women or as even men, you know, say people, do we contribute to also protecting the other communities, the other minority communities who have stayed back, like say Kishwar Jahan, like say Nasima Deh? How do we contribute to their keeping? How much are we trying to keep back the people who out of good faith in our country, in our part of the state, like in West Bengal, how much are we contributing as men and women to keep them back? Are we doing any that sort of a social and community service? There are clues from where I have got this, but not enough elaboration. Okay, so this could probably be done. Some names we have, which have come in, Duminita. Shukumari Choudhury, Nolini Mitro, Nibedita Nag. Nibedita Nag particularly, who has moved over to East Pakistan to work. To work with Nibedita Nag, please note this, she has moved over to East Pakistan to keep on this good job of, you know, giving the idea that we can work with the minorities, we are there with the minorities and we are one. So this goodwill ambassadoring, how much of this has come in, you know, through Partition and the voice of women, especially. Okay, I hope I am making some sense. I hope. Okay, and the last thing is that, you know, which again, you know, only in very important women's interviews it has come up, you know, their engagement with Mahatma Gandhi, 1946, that phase, you know, the interviews which I have come across, published interviews, were with Ashoka Gupta, Neeli Sen Gupta, and even Kishwar Jahan. As a child, she had met Mahatma Gandhi, the good fortune of being initiated into secular politics. But you see, I have deliberately eschewed mentioning the interviews of Ashoka Gupta and Neeli Sen Gupta because you see, they were very important women. Important and known women, they took part in governance. And I have categorically, you know, told that our project should be about unknown people. So why to quote again, you know, already people who had formulated policies. Ashoka Gupta was one of them. So, you know, they had spent a lot of time with Gandhi and his influence on the partition in the East. If at all, could we go into? Some of us could go into. That's it. Thank you.